so. Every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together.
Congress passes the most sweeping civil rights bill ever to be written into the law, and thus reaffirms the conception of equality for all men that began with Lincoln and the Civil War 100 years ago. The Negro won his freedom then. He wins his dignity now. 5 hours after the House passes the measure, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 is signed at the White House by President Johnson. Before an audience of legislators and civil rights leaders who had labored long and hard for passage of the bill, President Johnson calls for all Americans to back what he calls a turning point in history.
We must not approach the observance and enforcement of this law in a vengeful spirit. Its purpose is not to punish. Its purpose is not to divide, but to end divisions. Divisions which have lasted all too long. Its purpose is national, not regional. This Civil Rights Act is a challenge to all of us to go to work in our communities and our states, in our homes and in our hearts, to eliminate the last vestiges of injustice in our beloved country. So, tonight I urge every public official, every religious leader, every business and professional man, every working man, every housewife, I urge every American to join in this effort to bring justice and hope to all our people and to bring peace to our land.
There's warm applause from members of both parties as the president sets to work. It is work. He uses nearly 100 pens to affix his signature and date. Souvenirs go to Republican leader Everett Dirksen and Democratic whip Hubert Humphrey. The president seems to have mastered the art of just touching each pen to the paper. Integration leader Martin Luther King receives his pen, a gift he said he would cherish. The Department of Justice will enforce the law if necessary. And G-Man Chief J. Edgar Hoover is present. Another group of pens is reserved for the Kennedys, and the Attorney General is entrusted with a half dozen. Now, this summer of 1964, the Civil Rights Bill is the law of the land. In the words of the President, it restricts no one's freedom so long as he respects the rights of others.
Mighty without missiles, able without an atomic arsenal, ready without rockets, real without bullets, an army tutored in living and loving and not in killing. We thank God for giving us a leader who was willing to die.
A man fills many roles in his lifetime. Provider, protector, master of the house. As a father, you have a vital role in your family's life. They depend on you to be there. We help to make sure you can fulfill that promise because, no matter what they call you, at the end of the day, you know you're just dad.
Let me express my deepest gratitude for the privilege of addressing this convention. Tonight is a particular honor for me because, let's face it, my presence on this stage is pretty unlikely. My father was a foreign student, born and raised in a small village in Kenya. He grew up herding goats, went to school in a tin roof shack. His father, my grandfather, was a cook, a domestic servant to the British. But my grandfather had larger dreams for his son. Through hard work and perseverance, my father got a scholarship to study in a magical place, America, that shone as a beacon of freedom and opportunity to so many who had come before.
I've been looking at the stars tonight, and I think, oh, how I missed that bright sun.